إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Verily the praise belongs to Allah. We praise Him, seek His assistance and forgiveness, and we seek refuge in Allah from the evil of ourselves and the evil consequences of our deeds. Whoever Allah guides, there is no one that can lead him astray. And whoever Allah leads astray, there is no one that can guide him. I bear witness that nothing deserves to be worshipped except Allah alone, and that He has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and His messenger. This evening, we would like to begin a class which we have entitled Character and Morals in the Sunnah. And character and manners in the Sunnah. This topic is based upon a number of hadith that we intend to look at and briefly discuss the meaning of those hadith as well as some of the legal rulings or benefits that may be derived from them. Tonight, as an introduction, we will discuss some topics other than those hadith which we intend to study during this course. In other words, during the next 8 weeks, inshallah, we would like to discuss 16 hadith that are from the book Bulughul Maraam min Adillat al-Ahkam by al-Imam al-Haafidh ibn Hajar Asqalaanee. And in the last chapter of that book, entitled Kitaab al-Jaami, the last chapter of Bulughul Maraam, entitled Kitaab al-Jaami. And Kitaab al-Jaami, the scholars of the Sunnah used to make as the last chapter in their books. And that chapter would include a number of various different topics. And from amongst the topics that's included in this last Kitab al-Jami'a from Bulughul Maram, a lot of those topics deal with character and manners. And we believe, and Allah knows best, that this is something that Muslims are in need of greatly. It is of the utmost importance, and for this reason, we have chosen this topic. There are 16 hadith that we want to take during these 8 weeks. And if Allah allows, perhaps we might take the next section that follows it, which are 14 hadith, and maybe the section which follows it, which are 11 hadith, and so on. But for now, inshallah, we're going to take these 16 hadith. Tonight, inshallah, if you look at the questionnaire study guide that we passed out, and those brothers, You didn't get one? Taib, yeah. If you look at the questionnaire study guide, then you will see that we have about 8 topics here. And each one of those topics are part of the introduction. Each one of those topics are part of the introduction to this class, which we hope, inshallah, will lay the foundation that will help us to be a little better prepared to benefit from those hadith that we want to study. And if you notice the format in this questionnaire study guide, in the beginning we will have the topics, maybe just 2 or 3 topics that we're going to take in each class. And after that we'll have a few questions, 3 or 4 questions that are related to the topic that we're going to discuss. And the purpose of this is for us to know what we're going to deal with, what are the topics that we want to talk about, and also you want to ask yourself, did you understand what was presented? And if you're able to answer those questions, at least you have the basic elements of what was discussed. And if you can't answer those questions, then that means you need to go back and do some review. So hopefully, inshallah, we encourage everybody to take notes by whatever is your choice of recording instruments, whether it's a pencil and a pen, or whether it's your telephone or some kind of recording device or whatever it is, you should take notes. It's very important, brothers. We don't have those kind of memories that we just remember everything. Rather, you have to write it down or you have to record it in some kind of way so that you can go back and review it if you really want to benefit. If you just want to come and sit in passively, then that's up to you. We don't have any ability to compel anyone. But we encourage, inshallah, brothers that and sisters, that if you intend to attend this class regularly, that you should bring something to record notes with, and you should try to be regular in attendance for these 8 weeks, just 2 months, and try to be punctual, inshallah, for Salatul Maghrib, so that we can start immediately. So the topics that we have here, number one, the importance of ikhlas. The importance of ikhlas. Number two, the importance of seeking knowledge and the status of Ahlul Ilm, the people of knowledge, the ulama, the scholars. Number three, a brief biography of the muallif, meaning the author of the book, the Bulughul Maraam. Number four, the author's introduction to the book, his own introduction, which is very brief, which he just gives a summary of what he intended with this book. And that's important for us to know before we study a book. What is the book about? What does it entail? What is its objective? And after that, we have the subject of this class, that is the importance of good character. The importance, why is good character important? And along with that, two types of character. And after that, finally, we have the status of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The status of the Messenger of Allah. What is his position in front of Allah and in front of the Muslims? And as sunnah, what is the meaning of as sunnah? Again, this class is character and manners in the sunnah. Meaning the character and the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And hopefully, inshallah, we'll cover these topics in time before the adhan for Isha. And if there's any questions or any comments or any corrections, then inshallah, we'll take a few minutes after the adhan of Isha before the Iqamah to entertain them. Before I start though, also let me just mention on the back of this questionnaire study guide, there's a hadith. And it's on the second page. Okay, that's right. We weren't able to copy it on both pages. So on the second page, there's a hadith, which is the first hadith that we want to discuss in this class next week. And usually we're going to give you the hadith, whether it's one or two or three hadith, we're going to give you them in advance before the class. We're going to send them out by email before the class, at least 3 or 4 days before, so you have a chance to see the hadith, to look at it, read it, try to memorize it. And if you want to look it up in books and read about it so you can come prepared, that's better even. But in any case, we hope that you will look at these hadith before the class and try to memorize some of them, because it's very important to memorize what we learn. We only have 16 hadith, so mashallah, if we have 8 weeks, if you memorize two every week, you can finish all of them. Those of you not memorizers, at least read it over and over until you at least digest the meaning of it, so that you have something to go away with. Notice that we have written a hadith in Arabic, in transliteration, and the translation. So those who can read Arabic, you should memorize it from Arabic. Don't even look at the transliteration. Don't look at it, please. If you can't read Arabic, then use the transliteration and try to memorize it in Arabic. If you can't do that, at least take the English and memorize the English. Because if you understand that these are the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and as Allah said in the Quran about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحِيُّهَا, that he doesn't speak. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ نَطَقَ, he doesn't speak, he doesn't say anything from his desires, from himself. He's not just making it up. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحِيُّهَا, but rather, whatever the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says is wahi, is revelation that has been revealed to him. That means these words have been revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just like the Quran was revealed to him. And that means it's entitled to, it's worthy of our utmost care and concern. And we should read it, and we should understand it, and if possible we should memorize it, inshallah. The first topic that we want to talk about is al-ikhlas. And I want to discuss briefly the first hadith from Sahih al-Bukhari. The first hadith that al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah mentioned, and it's not from the hadith of this class, but it's a hadith for the introduction. And that hadith, the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, al-Imam al-Bukhari, who is one of the greatest scholars of hadith in the history of Islam, he is known amongst the people of Sunnah as Amir al-Mu'mineen fil hadith. Amir al-Mu'mineen fil hadith. Why? Is he the Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers? Because of the work that he did in the collection of the authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. So it entitled him to be called the Amirul Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers, because of the work that he did in that book, Sahih al-Bukhari. And some of the scholars said that the whole Muslim ummah is indebted to Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah because of the work that he has done in collecting the authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And that debt has only been fulfilled when someone has done a service to the work that he did. And one of the greatest of those who served Sahih al-Bukhari is Haafidh ibn Hajar Asqalaanee in the book, The Explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, Fath al-Bari. And Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar Asqalaanee is the scholar who we want to discuss his collection of hadith, that is Bulughul Maraam. He is also the one who explained Sahih al-Bukhari. And this first hadith that Imam Bukhari included in his book, the Sahih, is the book of sincerity, the hadith of sincerity, the hadith of ikhlas, the hadith of intentions, where it is reported, عن أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول that the Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers, يعني the first Khalifa of the Muslims, the second Khalifa of the Muslims, Umar bin al-Khattab رضي الله عنه, he said, I heard the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم saying, إنما الأعمال بالنيات, that verily actions are judged by intentions. Actions will be judged, will be weighed according to the intention that prompted that action. What was the intention behind it? That verily actions will be judged by its intentions. And this is the most important thing that will be considered. If an action is correct and right in accordance with the sunnah, the only other consideration is whether or not the action was done purely for the sake of Allah. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that he heard the message of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, that verily indeed actions are judged by intentions and only by intentions. وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, and every person will have that which he has intended. People will get that which they intended. When a person does something, their reward, their compensation, whether good or bad, it will be in accordance with their intention. And then the Prophet ﷺ, after stating this, and this is the principle that we really want to talk about, that actions are judged according to intentions, and every person will have that which they intended. The Prophet ﷺ, after making this statement, he clarified it with an example, and he said, فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. So whoever made hijrah, who migrated from one land to another, whoever migrated for Allah and His Messenger, then his hijrah will be judged accordingly. He will be rewarded with a reward, the reward of the one who has migrated for Allah and His Messenger. وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِلدُّنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَجْرَ إِلَيْهِ. But whoever made hijrah, whoever migrated, left their land to go to another land, in that case they were leaving Mecca to go to Medina. But whoever made hijrah for the dunya, to achieve or to receive something from the worldly things, or for a woman that he wanted to marry, then his hijrah, his reward for his hijrah will be accordingly. It will be accordingly. He made hijrah for some worldly benefit, then his reward will be according to that. He made hijrah to receive a woman's hand in marriage, then his hijrah will be in accordance with what he made hijrah for. So this is only an example, and we're not so concerned about the example, except to say that the example that he gave is significant for us, living in a place where Muslims should not be living. So I will only say this, and I will pass over it and leave it for another occasion, that the example that the Prophet ﷺ gave here of hijrah is a reminder to us of the importance of migrating for the sake of Allah. The Muslims should migrate for the sake of Allah from the place where they're not able to worship Allah the way He deserves to be worshipped, to a place where they're able to worship Allah in the way that He deserves to be worshipped. And hijrah is made obligatory on the Muslims. And whoever wants to understand it well, just read Surah An-Nisa, the fourth surah of the Quran, ayah 97, 98, 99, and 100. And read the tafsir of Ibn Kathir, and then you'll see the importance of this matter of al-hijrah. In any case, that's not our topic for now. But rather our topic is the intentions. And Shaykh Abdullah ibn Abdurrahman ibn Salih Ali Bassam, rahimahullah, one of the great scholars of our time, who was a companion student with Shaykh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, a student of Shaykh Abdurrahman al-Sa'adi. He says in his book Taysir al-A'lam, the Sharh Umdat al-Ahkam, concerning this particular hadith, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, that actions are judged according to intention. He said, this is a hadithun azimun, a great, tremendous hadith. وَقَائِدَةٌ جَلِيلَةٌ مِنْ قَوَاعِدَ الْإِسْلَامِ, and a lofty principle, a very sublime principle from the principles of Islam. Meaning what? That actions are judged according to intentions. And it is the correct, authentic rule of measurement for weighing a person's deeds. They will be weighed according to intentions. From the position or perspective of al-qubul wa-adamuhu, will their deed be accepted or will not be accepted? It will be based upon their intention. وَمِنْ حَيْثُ كَثْرَةُ الثَّوَابُ وَقِلَّتُهُ, or from the perspective of how much, the amount of their reward. Will it be a lot or will it be a little bit? It will be determined by the person's intention. It will be determined by the person's intention. So verily the Prophet ﷺ has informed us that the base point about which everything is returned to in terms of actions is the intentions, that we will have to go back and look at the intentions. Everything will refer back to the intention. If the action is done correctly, then the only consideration will be the intention. So whoever's intention was salihah, it was righteous, and his action was khalisa, purely for the sake of Allah the Most High, then his action will be accepted. And whoever's action was other than that, then his action will be rejected. Indeed, Allah is the one who is most without need of any partner. He doesn't need any partner or anyone to share with him. And then the Shaykh says the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in this hadith the example of hijrah. And we talked about that already. Then he says, وَالنِّيَّةُ تُمَيِّزُ الْعِبَادَ عَنَ الْعَادَةِ, that intentions distinguishes the ibadah from the ada. Intentions distinguish and separate that which is considered worship from that which is just considered habits, things that people just normally do. Intentions distinguish between whether or not a person who gets under some water and washes their body, takes a ghusl, is it ibadah or is it adah? Is it ibadah, worship? Is his intention to take a ghusl, to clean himself and purify himself, to worship Allah, to make salat? Or something of this nature? Or is his intention just to wash his body because he just came home from work and he's dirty and he just want to get clean? Or it's hot outside and he just want to cool down? That's not ibadah. The intention. When a person takes a ghusl, he should have intention. What is he doing this ghusl for? And the intention will distinguish between that which is worship and that which is just normal behavior, customs of the people, the normal habits of what people do every day. Secondly, he said that the niyyah in the sharia, it has two points of research that we need to look at. One of them is the one that we are concerned with today. That is, al-ikhlas fi al-amal lillahi wahdahu. That a person has purity of intentions to do a deed for the sake of Allah alone. This is the intention that we are concerned about. The intention that relates to whether or not a person does something purely for the sake of Allah alone, to earn Allah's reward, to earn the pleasure of Allah. Is that why they're doing it, or are they doing it for some other reason? The other matter of intention is something different. That's also in the sharia, and that is tamyiz al-adat ba'duha al-ibadat ba'duha an ba'd. That is distinguishing different types of worship, one from another. Meaning, a person has intention to pray 2 rak'ah. Does he have intention to pray 2 rak'ah as a sunnah, nafil, voluntary prayer, or 2 rak'ah as a fard, wajib, obligatory prayer? Is his intention when he prays those 2 rak'ah to pray as a voluntary prayer, like 2 rak'ah before Salatul Fajr? Or is his intention to pray it as an obligatory prayer, the two rak'ah of Fajr, the congregational prayer of Fajr. Both of them are two rak'ah. One is a voluntary prayer and one is obligatory prayer. So his intention when he gets ready to pray should be one or the other. So intentions distinguish different acts of worship that are related to one another, but they have different grades or different classes. One could be obligatory and one could be voluntary. So he makes intention that this is a voluntary prayer. Or he makes intention that this is an obligatory prayer. That's, we're not concerned about that issue of intention. But what we are concerned about under intention here, we're concerned about whether or not a person has intention to do whatever act he's doing, whether it's voluntary or obligatory. But is he doing it purely for the sake of Allah alone? Or is he doing it because the people are watching him? And he happened to be in the masjid. And if he doesn't pray, people might look at him and wonder what's wrong with him. They might say, are you a Muslim? People are praying and you're not praying. So he gets up and prays. Not for Allah, but he gets up and prays for the people to see him. This is the intention that we're concerned about. Whether or not a person does something purely for the sake of Allah alone. The Shaykh mentions a couple of things and we're going to close this point here. He says that from this hadith, we understand number one, that the central factor that actions should always be referred back to is an-niyat, the intentions. We got to look at intentions. That's very important. That is, this will determine if that act will be sahih or fasid. Will it be valid, acceptable, or will it be unacceptable, invalid? Will it be the kamal or the naqs? Will it be complete and perfect or will it be defective? We have to look at the intention. Whether the intention was pure or was it corrupted with something else. Or whether the act is ta'a or ma'asiyah. Is it an act of obedience or an act of disobedience? We look at intentions for these things. So whoever did an act, a deed in which he intended to be seen by people, then he has fallen into sin. He has fallen into sin. So every act of worship that we do, we should make sure that our intention is to do it purely for the sake of Allah. And one of the reasons why we are mentioning this topic tonight is because as we begin this class, we want to make sure that we are here for the sake of Allah. That our intention in being here is not to be on the scene. I was there when it happened. Or to hang out or meet somebody. But rather we should be here to learn, to be reminded, to remember what we have forgotten. So that we can worship Allah. There shouldn't be any other intention. Don't come here because they're giving out fruit or juice or coffee or tea or cookies or whatever they might be giving out. Maybe they're not giving out anything. But if they were giving out something, that's not what we're here for. But rather we're here, hopefully, in order to remind one another to learn something new or to be reminded of something that we have forgotten. Or just to hear again and review that which we already know. Maybe we already know this. It's okay. It's still a review. The second thing the Shaykh said, that an-niyya shart asasi fil amal. That niyya, intention, is a basic, fundamental, principal condition for any deed to be accepted. For any action to be accepted. This is the asas, the foundation that you build upon, correct intentions. Number three, أَنَّ النِّيَّ مَحَلُّهُ الْقَلْبُ. That the place for the niyyah is the heart. وَاللَّفْظُ بِهَا بِدَعَةٌ. And to pronounce it, to pronounce the niyyah is innovation. The place for the niyyah is the heart. You don't have to say anything. When you're getting ready to make salat, I intend to make dhuhr, obligatory prayer, four rak'ah, or whatever people be saying. That they just made up. You don't have to say any of that. You just have to have the resolve, the intent in your heart, in your mind of what you're about to do. The place of the intention is the heart. It's not to be pronounced. Number four, he said, wujub al-hadr min al-riya wa sam'a wal amal li ajli al-dunya. That it's obligatory on us to be warned and to be cautioned from al-riya and al-sam'a. To do something to be seen or to be heard. To do something so that people see you. And they say, wow, look at him, mashallah, look at her. She's doing it, she's doing that, he's doing this. Mashallah, he's very righteous. She's very whatever. Also, people can hear about you. Did you hear what I did? People were talking about me. Sum'a, to be heard. They do it so that they could be famous, so people could talk about them and praise them. We have to be warned from these things, doing things to be seen or to be heard, or to do any deed for the dunya, to get some benefit of the worldly things. We should not do any act of worship that is intended to be done for the sake of Allah, and our intention is to get some worldly benefit. While our intention is to get some worldly benefit. From these points, I think it should be clear to us, brothers, the importance of intention. That is something we should pay attention to. Naam? That the niyyah, it is a principal, primary condition for any deed. Meaning that the acceptance of a deed is conditional, that you have the proper intention. And it's a fundamental condition, a primary condition, that without which the deed is not accepted. And after that we said that the place of the intention is the heart. And after that we said the obligation of being warned and cautioned against doing anything to be seen or to be heard or for worldly benefit. So we should give attention to these things, brothers. Pay attention to our intentions. Pay attention to your intention. And make sure that it's purely for the sake of Allah alone. The second point that we want to discuss tonight is the importance of seeking knowledge and the status of the Ahlul Ilm, the ulama, the scholars, the people of knowledge. There's no doubt that knowledge, seeking it, seeking knowledge is of the utmost importance for a Muslim. It's not possible for a person to worship Allah without knowledge. It's not possible for a person to worship Allah without knowledge. That's why he sent prophets and messengers to teach the people so they will know what he wants them to do and what he wants them not to do. What is pleasing to him and what's displeasing to him? Who are the people that we should be around and the people that we should not be around? You have to have knowledge. And today that knowledge comes in Islam. It comes from what Allah has revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran and the authentic sunnah. The authentic sunnah. The importance of knowledge and the status, the elevated status of the people of knowledge. Just a couple of ayats as a reminder to us, and hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam quickly for us to be reminded of the importance of knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Az-Zumar 39, Surah 39, ayat 9, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُوا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ Are those who know and those who do not know equal? Allah told the Prophet ﷺ, قُلْ Say to them. There's something for us to think about. It's not really a question that requires an answer. Rather, it's a question that's really a statement. قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي Are they equal? الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ Are they equal? It's obviously not. People who have knowledge and the people who are ignorant, they are not equal. This is a question, the answer to which is known. For Muslims anyway. Verily, only the people of understanding take heed to this matter. That the people who know and the people who don't know are not equal. We are not equal to the people who know if we don't know. We are not equal to the scholars. Because of the knowledge that they have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Fatir, Surah 35, ayah 28. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهِ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ غَفُورٌ إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهِ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ That verily, it is only those who have knowledge among His servants. مِنْ عِبَادِهِ The servants of Allah. Only those amongst His servants who have knowledge. They are the only ones who have khashya. The real khashya, fear of Allah. Meaning the consciousness of Allah that motivates a person to do that which Allah has commanded and to avoid that which Allah has prohibited? Only the people who have knowledge. Innama means verily. It means more than verily. Inna means verily. Innama means verily. These and only these. Innama yakhsha Allah min ibadihi al-ulama. It's only the people of knowledge. To the extent of a person's knowledge will be the extent of their khashya, their fear of Allah. Only the people of knowledge have the real fear of Allah. And the saying of Allah in Surah Ali Imran, Surah 3, Ayah 18, شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَأُولِ الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ. That Allah bears witness that no one has the right to be worshipped except Him. شَهِدَ اللَّهُ. Allah Himself bears witness that no one has the right to be worshipped except Him. وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ. And also the angels bear witness that no one has the right to be worshipped except Allah. وَعُولِ الْعِلْمِ. And the people who possess knowledge, the ulama, they bear witness that no one has the right to be worshipped except Allah. This ayah makes us to know the status of the people of knowledge. Because Allah has placed the people of knowledge with the angels and Allah Himself in bearing witness and being entitled to bear witness to something because they have knowledge. Because the people who don't have knowledge don't have the right to bear witness to anything. What are you bearing witness to? You don't know nothing about it. How can you bear witness to what happened and you weren't there? You don't know about this. So Allah says that He Himself bears witness to the greatest truth, the greatest reality, La ilaha illallah. Allah bears witness to this, and the angels bear witness to this, and along with them Allah said, and the ulul ilm. And finally, from Surah Al-Zukhruf, Surah 43:86, وَلَا يَمْلِكُ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ الشَّفَاعَةَ إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. And those whom they invoke instead of Him, those who they call upon instead of Allah, have no power or ability of intercession. They cannot intercede. إِلَّا except مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ, except the one who testifies to the truth, while they know. وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. Wow here is wow al-hal. It means, it doesn't mean except those who bear witness to the truth, and they know. No. شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. Wow here is not wow al-atif. It's wow al-hal. It means that they bear witness to the truth while knowing what they are bearing witness to. Because you can't bear witness without knowledge. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith that's reported in the Sunnah of Ibn Majah, the hadith is Hassan. Talibul ilm faridatun ala kulli muslim. That seeking knowledge is obligatory, it's fard for every Muslim. And the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith that's in Sahih Muslim, مَنْ مَاتَ يَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. That whoever dies, knowing, having knowledge of this reality that nothing deserves to be worshipped except Allah, he has entered the paradise. Because he knows this reality. And of course, it has other conditions besides knowledge. But this shows the importance of knowledge. And the Prophet ﷺ in a hadith as reported in the Sunan of Ibn Majah in Sahih, he used to say, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafiyan. Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafiyan. O Allah, I ask of you beneficial knowledge. And this supplication of the Prophet ﷺ is the messenger of Allah asking Allah to give me beneficial knowledge. That means that we should also ask Allah to give us beneficial knowledge. Because of the importance and the benefit of knowledge, if it is proper, good, accurate, correct knowledge. And he called it beneficial knowledge, as opposed to other knowledge, which is not beneficial. Not all knowledge is beneficial. But the most beneficial knowledge is the knowledge of the Qur'an and Sunnah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also used to supplicate, as reported in the Sahih of Ibn Hibban, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa'u wa min 'amalin la yurfa'u wa min du'ain la yusma'u. That, O Allah, I seek refuge in you from knowledge which does not benefit, and from actions or deeds which are not raised up to Allah, not accepted by Allah, and from a supplication that is not heard by Allah. Allah doesn't listen to it. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa'u. O Allah, I seek refuge in you from knowledge that does not benefit. Allahumma inni as'aluka ilman nafi'an. O Allah, I ask you for beneficial knowledge. Wa a'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa'u. And I seek refuge with you from knowledge that does not benefit. Some of us waste our time in seeking knowledge that is of no benefit. It's of no benefit. Like, how many points did LeBron James score in the All-Star game? In 19, I don't know, when did he start playing basketball? Huh? How many championships did, how many so-and-so win? How many touchdowns did that guy carry or whatever? That is knowledge, wallahi, brothers. And I'm not saying this to the children, because they're children, they don't really know any better. I'm saying this to the adults. That's knowledge that's of no benefit. The Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sought refuge in Allah from knowledge that is of no benefit. That knowledge will not help you get near to Allah. It will not weigh of anything good on your scales on Yawm al-Qiyamah. It will not be a means for you to enter the paradise. If anything, it will occupy you from that which is of benefit and cause you to be shortchanged and perhaps fall into a different condition. May Allah help us and protect us and save us from that. The next two points that I want to discuss quickly, brothers, is the brief biography of the author, the Mu'allif, and his introduction to the book. The book that we are taking our 16 hadith from, that is Bulughul Maraam, Min Adillat al-Ahkam. It's Surah 46, Surah Zukhruf. This biography is short, and we will maybe even summarize it a little bit more, and perhaps inshallah we'll send it to you by email. If we don't have your email address, brothers or sisters, please give us your email address or email address where we can send you the notes. Whenever we have notes for this class, from time to time we will have some extra notes that we could send to you in case you're not good at writing or recording. Sometimes the recording machines break down and you didn't get it, or the sound might not be good. So some of the notes, inshallah, we'll try to send to you. The author's biography, the full name of the famous Imam Al-Haafidh ibn Hajar Asqalaanee. This is what he is known as, Al-Haafidh ibn Hajar Al-Asqalaanee. But his full name is Abu al-Fadl Shihabuddin. And these notes, inshallah, I'll send to you, because I know it's too much to write. Abu al-Fadl Shihabuddin Ahmed ibn Ali ibn Muhammad ibn Muhammad ibn Ahmed al-Kinani al-Shafi'i. Abu al-Fadl Shihabuddin Ahmed ibn Ali ibn Muhammad ibn Muhammad ibn Ahmed al-Kinani al-Shafi'i. Anybody can give it back to me? Study it, inshallah. Okay, Abu al-Fadl Shihabuddin Ahmed ibn Muhammad ibn Muhammad ibn Ahmed al-Kinani al-Shafi'i. For short, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalaanee. He was born on the 10th of Sha'ban in the year 773 of the Hijra in Egypt, Misr, where he also grew up. And he memorized the Quran at the age of 9 years old. Some of us who have children, get busy, brothers. Get busy. He memorized the Quran, finished it when he was 9 years old. He also memorized Al-Hawi, the book Mukhtasar of Ibn Hajib, and other books. He traveled to Mecca and listened to the teachings of its scholars. He admired the knowledge of Hadith and began to acquire it from the great sheikhs in Hijaz. That is in the area of Saudi Arabia today, in Mecca area, Mecca and that area of Saudi Arabia. And Asham, that's the area today in the world that's called Syria and Lebanon and Palestine. That area of the world was called Asham and Egypt. And he stayed with Az-Zain al-Iraqi for 10 years. He also studied with al-Balqini and Ibn al-Mulaqqin and others. He learned the two sources, Quran and Hadith, from Al-Izz ibn Jama'ah, an Arabic language from Al-Majj, Al-Fayruz, Al-A'abadi. And he studied literature and poetry from al-Bada al-Mushtaqi and writing from another group of teachers. And he also recited some parts of the Quran in all seven styles of recitation from al-Tanuqi. Meaning he memorized the Quran and he also learned the different modes of recitation of the Quran. He occupied himself with the promotion of knowledge of hadith. So he dwelt in its study, teaching, writing, and giving fatawa. He also taught tafsir, interpretation of the Quran, hadith, fiqh, jurisprudence, and preached at many places like Al-Azhar and Jami Al-Amr and others. He authored more than 150 books. Most of them being in the studies of hadith, which flourished during his lifetime. And the kings and princes exchanged them as gifts. Instead of giving cars and boats and homes, they used to give books. The books that were written by Haafidh bin Hajar Asqalaanee. His most worthy of mentioning is Fath al-Bari, the commentary of Sahih al-Bukhari, which he began in the beginning of the year 817 of the Hijrah, after finishing its introductory part in 813. Meaning he wrote the introduction in 813, and he began writing the actual commentary of Sahih Bukhari in 817, and he finished it in Rajab in the year 842. He started in what year? 817 and finished 842. How many years it took him to write the book? Come on, mathematicians. Huh? 25 years. You see that book on the shelf? The brothers can see it. On the top shelf, on the right side of the bookshelf, those green books, not the red ones, the green ones. 13 volumes. The smallest volume has at least 500 pages. And the biggest volume has almost 1,000 pages. 13 volumes. Took him 25 years to write it. This is a book worthy of being studied. We're just going to take his little book, Bulughul Maraam, just a little chapter from it. Inshallah, we're going to study that. He became the Qadi of Egypt, and then Sham was added to his jurisdiction, which he held for more than 21 years. He was the chief Qadi until the year 852, the year in which he died. As concerns his personality, he was humble, tolerant, patient, and enduring. He was also described as being steadfast, prudent, ascetic, selfless, generous, charitable, and a person praying and fasting voluntarily. He also had good manners in dealing with all the imams of the earlier generations and the later generations. He had respect for the people of knowledge. And he also had good manners in dealing with those who sat with him, whether young or old. He had good manners. And that's our topic, manners, character and manners, inshallah. As far as the introduction to the book, just briefly, the Shaykh, he mentions the introduction in just a couple of paragraphs. He says, praise be to Allah for His apparent and concealed bounties at all times. For Allah's apparent and concealed bounties. Praise be to Allah for the bounties, the favors, the blessings that are seen openly and those which are not seen. And Allah is blessing us all the time. Are we praising Him for it? Or are we ungrateful? And peace and blessings be upon His Prophet and Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, His family and companions who strove steadfastly in the path of serving Allah's religion. And their followers who inherited the knowledge. For the ulama are the heirs of the prophets. And may they be honored. May they be honored, the scholars. May they be honored, whether they be warith, those who inherit, or mawruth, those who are inherited from. To proceed, this is a concise book. Okay, this book, Bulughul Maram, is a small book. It's a mukhtasa, very small book. Concise book. It's not like Bukhari or Muslim or some big books. It's a small book. Comprising the hadith evidence sources for the Sharia rulings. Meaning the hadith which are used for making legal rulings in the Sharia. These are just hadith that are related to legal rulings. There are all kinds of other hadith. These are hadith related to legal rulings, which I have compiled meticulously, he said. And he's a great scholar. He took time to compile this little book. This is not just an ordinary book that anybody collected. You and I can collect hadith. But it's not going to be like this. Because this is a man who has knowledge. Extensive knowledge. And he collected it, he said, meticulously. So that the one who memorizes it excels among his peers. It may assist the beginner student, and the learned one seeking more knowledge may find it indispensable. But he said what? So that it could be memorized. So inshallah, we're going to try to memorize some of these hadith. We're going to try to memorize some of these hadith. Is anybody afraid to try to memorize hadith? Any of you brothers afraid to try to memorize some of these hadith? Because if you're afraid, it's going to be difficult. But if you're not afraid, wallahi, brother, if we sat here right now for 5 minutes, you can memorize one of them. 5 minutes. And we did it a lot of times, brother. We have done it a lot of times. Brother said he can't memorize. I said, come sit down. 5 minutes, you can memorize a hadith. So don't be afraid. If the one is too long, pick a shorter one. But memorize some of these hadith, inshallah, please. For your own sake. He said, I've indicated at the end of every hadith the imam who collected it. In order to fulfill the trust, the amana to the Muslim ummah. Meaning, I didn't just collect hadith, but I tell you where it came from. And he has a mustalah, a technical language that he used, that he mentions at the end of every hadith. He says, for example, the sab'a, the seven. This stands for a hadith that was collected by seven scholars of hadith. And the seven that he's talking about is Ahmed, al-Imam Ahmed, al-Bukhari and Muslim, Abu Dawud and Nasai, al-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah. I'm going to send these notes to you, inshallah. But Imam Ahmed, al-Bukhari and Muslim, that's easy. Imam Ahmed and Bukhari and Muslim. And the four books of Sunan, Abu Dawud and Nasai, al-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah. That's the seven. The four books of Sunan, the two books of Sahih, and the Muslim Imam Ahmed. So if he says seven, he said all of them collected it. He said, if I say six, this stands for all of them except Imam Ahmed. Bukhari and Muslim and the four Sunan, except Imam Ahmed. If I say five, it stands for all of them except Bukhari and Muslim. Meaning Ahmed and the four Sunan. Abu Dawud, Nasai, Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah. Ahmed and those four, if he said five. If he said four, he means those four, meaning Abu Dawud and Nasai, Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah. He said, if I said three, then I mean all except the first three and the last one. The first three is what? Ahmed and Bukhari and Muslim. And the last one is Ibn Majah. When you read this book, you gotta learn this technical language so you know what he's talking about, what he's saying. But in the translation, anyway, they'll tell you. They won't just say three, they'll tell you which three they're talking about. Sometimes if it was narrated by Bukhari and Muslim, you'd say Muttafaqun Alayh. That we know about Muttafaqun Alayh, right? That's agreed upon by Bukhari and Muslim. And then he says, and whatever is besides these seven collectors is clear. Meaning, I will make it clear to you. I will tell you that is narrated by Abu Dawud al-Tayalisi, not Abu Dawud al-Sijistani. I will tell you that it's in the Muwatta of Imam Malik, or it's in the Sunan of al-Darimi, or whatever other book it may be in. I will tell you, I will make it clear. But if it's from these seven, then this is the terminology that we use. Should I have named this book, Bulughul Maraam and Adillat al-Ahkam? And I pray to Allah not to render what we have learned a calamity against us. I pray to Allah not to make it a calamity against us, our knowledge. But may He guide us to act according to what pleases Him, the glorified, the exalted one. Meaning I pray to Allah that He doesn't make the knowledge that we are seeking a calamity for us. In that we seek knowledge and then don't act upon it. But rather, may He give us the tawfiq, the success, to seek knowledge and act upon it. So these hadith dealing with character and manners are 16 hadith that you can act upon. And then it won't be against you. As the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Qur'an, hujjatun laka wa alayka. The Qur'an is a hujjah, a proof for you or against you. If you act upon it, it will be for you. You learn the Qur'an and act upon it, it will be for you. But if you learn and don't act upon it, it will be against you. And this knowledge is like that. And Al-Haafidh ibn Hajar Asqalaanee is saying that I pray to Allah that He doesn't make this knowledge against us, a calamity upon us, that we seek knowledge and then we don't act upon it. Or rather, it should be for us. The topic of this class, brothers, in the few minutes that's remaining, is the importance of character and manners. And that's what we want to talk about now. And perhaps the last two topics, the status of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sunnah, we may save for the next class if we don't have enough time. And in the next class, inshallah, we'll take the first hadith, which is on the second page of these papers that we gave out. The first hadith that we'll take next week, inshallah, will be this hadith, the rights of a Muslim are six. What we want to discuss right now, brothers, is the importance of this topic of character and manners. And there are a few ayahs from the Quran and hadith that we want to look at quickly so that we can see how important is this topic. Inshallah, after the Adhan, we'll just take a few minutes, brothers, to just look at this topic just quickly. And then probably we'll finish the rest of the topics, inshallah, in the next session, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Inshallah, whenever it's time for salat, brothers, we should stop immediately and call the Adhan. And inshallah, usually the Adhan is going to be, 15 to 20 minutes. I mean, the Iqama, 15 to 20 minutes later. No. Bismillah, wa salatu wa salam, wa rasulillah. Brothers, please excuse me. I misjudged the timing, and maybe I intended to present more topics than we have time to present. And rather than rush through it, perhaps we might entertain questions. If there's any questions about what we discussed, then perhaps we can take some questions. And also, I will make a note that we did send an attendance sheet to the sisters. So hopefully the sisters sign the attendance and return it to us. And brothers also, if you're in the class, you intend to attend the class, please sign the attendance also. And especially brothers, if we don't have your email address, please give us your email address if you intend to attend the class so that we can send you the notes that we may be able to prepare. Some of the notes to help you with the notes that you're taking, inshallah, we can send them to you by email. If you don't have an email address, you can try to get one. Any of the brothers or sisters, if it's a sister can help you. Or if you know somebody that you have access to, that you can receive it through, please give us an email address so that we can communicate with you and send you the notes that we will be having from class to class, especially the hadith that will be taken for each class, we'll be sending them. Are there any questions or any comments or any correction from what has been said? It may be a little difficult for the sisters, but sisters, if you have a question, for now, if you can just write it down briefly, and otherwise in the future what we'll try to do is if a brother is here, whose wife is here, then if the sisters have a question, they can just use the telephone. Sister can call her husband and give him the question, and we can entertain it. Otherwise, inshallah, for now, you can write it down. Or we get an intercom system, that's what we used to use, that's what I used to use. And we just have, my wife, inshallah, give me the question, and we'll try to address them. We don't want to leave the sisters out, that's really the point. You know, this, alhamdulillah, the Muslims are ummah, and this ummah includes men, women, and children. And we don't want to leave anybody out. We want the sisters to feel that they, you know, because they're in a separate room, that we forgot about them. If they have questions, we definitely want to entertain them, if we can. I mean, if there's a question that we can answer. Okay, you had a question? Somebody had their hand up? Somebody had their hand up? Yes, Bilal. Try to make the question concise so I can repeat it for the sisters, inshallah. No.
No.
How can he bear witness? He wasn't there. He wasn't where? All right. Okay. The brother is saying that we mentioned in the introduction to this class today that the saying of Allah, شَهِدَ اللَّهُ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْعُلِ الْعِلْمِ قَائِمًا بِالْقِسْطِ, that Allah bears witness that no one deserves to be worshipped except Him and the angels and the people of knowledge. And what do we bear witness to? لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. And as a Muslim, when we enter Islam, we say, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ مُحَمَّدُ رَسُولُ اللَّهُ. We bear witness that there's nothing which deserves to be worshipped except Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. And he said his son asked him, how can he bear witness when he wasn't there? Meaning he wasn't in Arabia 1400 years ago when the Prophet ﷺ was living. You bear witness by knowledge, by seeking knowledge. Okay? The same way that you bear witness to anything that you didn't witness, if you have an access to a source of knowledge about that thing, then you study it. You read about it, you investigate it, you ask about it, you reflect upon it until you know something about it. And then you bear witness to that which you know. Okay? We can bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah by studying his life. If anybody study his life, then they will see. And we will see in these hadith that we're going to take, the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the example, the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a testimony that he is the messenger of Allah. One example of this, brothers, and this really, we don't want to take a lot of time, but perhaps there's some other questions because it's not related to our topic now. An example of this is the hadith that's in Bukhari. Some of you may have read the incident in the early days of the mission of the Prophet ﷺ, when some of the people migrated to different lands because they were persecuted in Mecca. And the ruler of the Byzantine Empire, the ruler of the Romans, he heard from a letter that was sent to him from the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, and he didn't know how to read or write, right? But he had somebody write it. And he used to send out dawah to the rulers of the different lands. And that ruler, who was the mightiest nation in the earth at the time, he asked, he wanted to know about this man who was claiming to be a messenger. So when some people came from the Quraysh, from Mecca, he called them in, said, bring those people in. I want to ask him about this man who sent this letter to me telling me to bear witness that no one deserves worship except Allah and that he's the messenger of Allah. Who is this man? So he brought them in and he asked from amongst them who was there. And he found out that there was one from amongst them who was a leader of the Quraysh. And he was a relative of the Prophet ﷺ. And he was Abu Sufyan. And Abu Sufyan at that time was a mushrik. He hadn't yet entered Islam. And he was an enemy of the Prophet ﷺ, an enemy of Islam. And the ruler started asking him questions about the Prophet ﷺ. And some of the questions that he asked him was about his character and his manners and his behavior. And was he truthful and was he honest? And when he makes a promise and when he is entrusted with something. And based on the character that the enemy of Islam, Abu Sufyan, who was a mushrik, had to testify to. Because there was people behind him who knew that if he lied, the ruler had said, if he says anything that's true, let me know. So he had to tell the truth. And he said, the man's, his character is impeccable. He's truthful, he's honest, he's just, he's fair. He looks out for the orphans and the weak people and the old people and the poor people and the hungry people. And the ruler of the Roman Empire said that indeed, this man is the messenger of Allah. And he said, if I could go to him, I would go to him. And if I went to him, I would wash his feet. And he will eventually, if he's really the messenger, he will rule over this kingdom. And that did happen. How did he know he was the messenger of Allah? He didn't see him, but he knew from his character that if this man is like this, then he's truthful. Then he wouldn't be lying. If he's truthful about these things, he won't be lying about something that's greater than that and more important than that. If anybody examined and studied the life of the Prophet ﷺ, it will become clear to them that he is the messenger of Allah. That's a fact. But of course, a person who doesn't study, he doesn't know. A person who doesn't know the messenger of Allah, we didn't read his life. We didn't study his life. So we don't really know. We might be in doubt. Is he really a messenger or not? Some Muslims are in doubt. They don't know if he's really the messenger. They don't know if Allah is really the supreme being, the one that alone deserves to be worshipped. They don't know. They're not sure. And that's why it's important to study, so you can know, so you have knowledge. When you have knowledge, then you'll be certain. Because a certain amount of knowledge, a certain level of knowledge, a person reaches a certain level of knowledge till it becomes yaqeen, certainty. And when a person becomes certain, they have no more doubt. This is what's required of a Muslim, that you study and you learn until you are certain and you have no doubt. You bear witness to this without having any doubt. Any other question? Naam.
We talk about the importance of seeking knowledge. I would imagine that any one of us went to Atlantic Avenue and went to buy books and would be intrigued by the titles of these books.
No.
However, I'd rather just do away a whole box of books.
No.
Recently, but they were not fit to be read.
No.
Also, we talked about translations. You know, we got today. In the cookbook, probably wasn't intentional, made a gross mistake with regard to the translation. I was saying, I was thinking that at some point during this course, that you probably can suggest some books that would benefit all of us.
Right. Importance of knowledge, going to bookstores where there are a lot of books, and being careful to choose the right books, because you may end up throwing them away. So can we suggest some books? Yes. Alhamdulillah, the first thing, brothers, you go to a bookstore, try to go to a bookstore that's known to have good books. Don't just go to any bookstore. Second thing, even if you go to a bookstore like Dar es Salaam, for example, that's not the only bookstore, but that's one bookstore. They have a lot of good books because they do pay attention to trying to sell books that are good. But not all the books that they sell are good. Not all the books they sell are good. Even though those people are people of Sunnah, they are the people of Sunnah, they're upon the Sunnah. But not all the books that they sell are good. So you have to be careful what you buy. You may end up finding out later to put that book in the trash. Like you said, brother, through a whole box of books. Not a box. Few boxes of books. Few boxes of books. Garbage. Rubbish. Okay, be careful what you buy. If you don't know, ask somebody before you spend your money. If you don't know, ask somebody. And better than that, ask somebody who knows. There are a lot of books you can get free. You don't have to spend money. You don't have to buy a book every time you need a book. There are a lot of books on the internet, good books. Inshallah, we'll give you some sites where you can get some books you can download free. Good books. All kind of books. Books of Islamic Aqidah, Hadith, Fiqh, Tafsir, all kind of books that you can get free. Okay? We will make a list, inshallah, and we'll try to, you know, begin to compile some list of books that we can recommend. Any other question? Please remind me. Naam. Naam. You got a question?
Oh.
Yeah, I did repeat. I said it quickly, though. I did repeat the question. I repeated it in summarized form. The brother was asking about going to the bookstore and where there are a lot of books and being intrigued about books. And how do you know which books to buy? Because he just heard about a brother who threw away some books. And he said, can we make a list of books? Yes, inshallah, we'll try to do that. Naam, Abdur-Rahim. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Naam, the book, The Prophet's Prayer Described, written by Shaykh Muhammad Nasruddin al-Albani, rahimahullah, is one of the best books that a Muslim can buy on Salat. I say one of the best, but I don't want to say the best because I haven't read every book. But from the books that I have read, certainly it has to be one of the best books. It's a must. What is it called? The Prophet's Prayer Described? Naam, Sifat Salat al-Nabi. The description of the Prophet's Prayer, or the Prophet's Prayer Described as they translate it in English, by Shaykh Muhammad Nasruddin al-Albani, is one of the best books that a Muslim can buy on Salah. It's a must. That you have to have it, brother. That you have to have it, and you have to read it, and you have to study it. Because a lot of people, they say things, and we tell them that's wrong. They say, where you get that from? So we got it from this book right here. They say, I read that book. So maybe you didn't read it well. You have to study it. You have to read it again and again and again. If you read it 10 times, you didn't read it enough. It's a treasure. A treasure, brother. The Prophet's Prayer Described by Sheikh Muhammad Nasruddin al-Albani. It may cost you about $10 or $15, or I don't know, stuff is high now, maybe $20. Even if you pay $50 for it, it's worth it, brother. Believe me, it's worth it. Naam. Nasruddin al-Albani. Rahimahullah. Naam. Anything else? Any question, brothers? About the topic. Everything that we presented tonight is clear? MashaAllah. Okay, brothers and sisters, inshallah. I expect you to look at, you know, the notes that you have taken or listen to your recording. And there are some questions on this questionnaire study guide. The reason why it's called a questionnaire study guide, because these questions help you. It guides you in your studies to make sure that you got the point, that you understand this. Okay, like, for example, one of the questions on here is, discuss briefly the importance of ikhlas, sincerity. Like, for example, how will you discuss this briefly? You say, for example, that ikhlas, sincerity, is the primary condition or the basis that determines whether deeds will be accepted or not. That's how important it is. You could, in your own words, something like that. Not a long, drawn-out essay. Mention a dalil showing the importance of seeking knowledge. You might mention a little hadith, for example, like talib al-ilm faridatun ala kulli muslim. You can learn that. Talib al-ilm faridatun ala kulli muslim. That's easy. That's a dalil. Okay? Or you might mention an ayah from the Quran. Kul hal yastawi alladhina ya'lamuna walladhina la ya'lamun. Like something like that. Just one dalil, one evidence from the Quran or from the Sunnah. Okay? This so that you know that you have something. If somebody wanted to debate with you whether or not seeking knowledge is important, you could tell them, brother, the Prophet ﷺ said, seeking knowledge is obligatory on every Muslim. Just like five prayers a day is obligatory. Fasting in Ramadan is obligatory. Seeking knowledge is obligatory, brothers, sisters. It's obligatory. It's not something that's optional. You do it if you feel like it or not. You must do it. You are in need of it. I am in need of it. We are in need of it. Part of the reason, and I say part of the reason, because it's not the only reason, but part of the reason that we're in trouble today, the Muslims I'm talking about, is because of the ignorance that's widespread amongst Muslims all over the earth, not just here in New York City. Mention the author's name, date of birth, death, something about his life and writings. Who knows the author's name? Any brother, tell me, what's the author's name? Huh? Al-Haafidh? Ibn Hajar Asqalaanee. Who knows his kunya? Or his laqab, or his first name, or his father's name. Abu Fadl. Naam, Shihabuddin. Naam, Ahmed. Ibn. Ahmed. Ibn Ali. Ibn Muhammad. Ibn Muhammad again. Ibn Ahmed. Yes. Just start with Ahmed and end with Ahmed. And Muhammad, two Muhammads in between. That's easy, right? Ahmed, Ibn Ali, Ibn Muhammad, Ibn Muhammad. Ibn Ahmed again. Ahmed again. Start with Ahmed, end with Ahmed. Ahmed Ibn Ali. Then two Muhammads and Ahmed again. Okay, Al-Kinani, Al-Shafi'i. Al-Kinani is the tribe, the people that he's from. Al-Shafi'i is the madhab of fiqh that he's from. Okay, so this is how it goes, like that, okay? Write the questions, write the answers, brothers and sisters, write the answers for yourself. Not for me to check or to get graded, but for you to know that you have it. And when you come next week, if you couldn't answer one of the questions, ask it. So that we could see who knows the answer, inshallah, so nobody goes out of here without knowing answers. If there's any other question, inshallah, we'll take it, and then we're going to pray, inshallah. Where's the imam? He's in the office? Okay, I don't know. What time is the iqamah? Okay, we have a couple of minutes. There's no questions? If there's no questions, I have some questions. You know, this is reciprocal. If you don't ask questions, I will. Okay, so better for you to ask questions. Jabir. Now, can the intention be what? Okay, that's a fit question. We're not really too concerned about that, okay? But in any case, I'll try to answer it if I can. Allah knows best. The brother is asking a question about actions. He said that we mentioned that actions are judged by intentions. And that actions or intentions distinguish between deeds. And we said that there's two issues related to intentions. One of them is actions that are intentions that distinguish that which is worship, ibadah, from that which is just a habit or a custom, adah. And the other issue is intentions distinguish between acts of worship that are of different classes, that something is obligatory or it's voluntary, okay? So now you're saying is, can you double up on intention? Can you make intention to do something as an obligatory act and as a voluntary act? Naam, in some cases it's permissible. In some cases, it's permissible. For example, when a person enters the masjid, they should pray two rak'ah, right? Tahiyatul masjid. The scholars differ about whether or not tahiyatul masjid is obligatory or not. And Allah knows best. It's certainly sunnah mu'akkada if it's not obligatory. It's a confirmed sunnah that nobody should ever abandon. Okay? Let's say that those scholars who say that it's not obligatory. So a person came in the masjid and he prays two rak'ah, tahiyatul masjid, right? Then he waits for the congregational prayer. Then he prays the congregational prayer. What if a person came and the iqamah is called? He has to join the line or she has to join the ranks and join the obligatory prayer, and they didn't get a chance to pray Tahiyatul Masjid. Can that prayer that they're praying serve as Tahiyatul Masjid?